It takes more than one person to assist in a personal injury claim. I am attorney Glenn Westmoreland, and we have a strong team at the Mack Law Firm. It is our goal to make sure your injury is properly attended to. Contact me at tangylawteam.com and let us get you the help you need.
All right, good evening once again, everyone. Now on the stage, we welcome our Hammond City mayoral candidates. The structure of the forum will be as follows, with questions rotated among the candidates. Earlier this evening, numbers were drawn to determine the order of questioning. Each candidate will have 90 seconds for opening remarks. There will be 8 total questions posed to the candidates. The first candidate will be asked a question and allowed 90 seconds to respond. Then, each of the other candidates will be allowed 60 seconds to comment on that same question. And at my discretion, I may use any unexpired time to pose follow-up questions. This process will repeat 7 more times, allowing each candidate to initially receive 2 questions. After all 8 questions have been posed, each candidate will have 2 minutes for closing remarks. Candidates have been provided a tablet and pen for taking notes while on stage. They are not allowed to have any notes, charts, cell phones, or any type of smart devices with them. Tonight's questions are the result of input gathered by the Tangipahoa Chamber of Commerce and North Shore Media Group listeners. No one, aside from Chamber and North Shore Media Group's upper management, have seen the questions until this evening. Now, let's begin with opening remarks. We'll begin in order of the numbers drawn, and each candidate will have 90 seconds. Having drawn number 1, candidate 1, Tracy Washington Wells. Tracy.
Good evening, Hammond, and welcome to tonight. My name is Tracy Washington Wells. I'm a mother, I'm a wife, but the most important thing about me is I'm a believer in Jesus Christ. I have over 30 years of public service at every government level, beginning at the local level with the 22nd Judicial District Attorney's Office, then on to the State of Louisiana Department of Social Services and Department of Health and Hospitals. I also worked at the federal level with the U.S. Food and Drug Administration. I've worked with Fortune 500 pharmaceutical companies and as a global operations auditor with the second largest generic drug company in the world. My grandparents lived on Mississippi Street, and that's where I was raised. All the land that you see beside and behind the Daily Star were my grandparents' land where they farmed. And the most impressive thing that they instilled in me was education. If you get a good education, Tracy, it will take you around the world. And that's exactly what it did. I acquired my Bachelor's of Science in Public Health, graduating magna cum laude from Dillard University. I have my Master's in Education, Concentration in Curriculum and Instruction from Concordia University. I am a strong proponent of education. As such, part of my platform is to have an expanded youth program. It's an honor and a privilege to be here tonight. And I would love for you all to consider me for your support. I am Tracy Washington Wells, number 70 on the ballot.
Now moving on to candidate 2, Daryl Smith. Daryl?
Thank you. I came to Hammond in 1983 to play a basketball game at the Baptist Student Center. I fell in love with the campus of Southeastern, and I was introduced to Hammond America. From that point, I started managing an apartment complex overlooking Kate Square Park. As a student, that property was foreclosed on, and I was evicted out of my apartment, moved into an abandoned home, lived there until I graduated. And soon after that, I started acquiring properties from Hammond to Central Louisiana to Mobile, Alabama. 40 years of working in the construction industry, acquisitions, management, timber, and agricultural investments. I feel very well comfortable to say that I have the credentials to be the mayor. There's utilities that the mayor has to manage, and they are drainage, sewage, garbage. And those responsibilities right now are not being done properly. They're mismanaged. So I feel very comfortable that I can address those issues. So please consider me on November the 8th. Thank you so very much.
Next candidate, candidate 3, Johnny Pecoraro.
Thank you, and thank you everyone for coming here tonight. My name is John Pecoraro, Johnny Pecoraro. Most people call me Johnny. I think most of you I know out there, we have the flower shop, Hammond Florist. We could go on for days on bio, and we'll get into that category, but I'm really here tonight because I want to talk about the issues that why I'm in this race, and because I feel as though it is my time to be in this race, number one. Number two, my family has been here for 120 years ago. They got off the train here with the dream of Hammond and this area, and I feel as though it's my need to fulfill this dream. Today's Hammond is not the Hammond that I want. So when I say taking it to the next level, what I am meaning by taking it to the next level or time for change, to me it is time for change. I find that the biggest issues that face us today is, of course, crime, sewage, and drainage, okay? These issues are beyond out of control right now. I mean, when we talk about crime, we have gangs in Hammond, and I'd be damned if I'm gonna let a gang hold me hostage to my home at night. I think we need better lighting, better security on our crime issue. I know we need... I'm sorry. So anyway, I think that we do need better drainage issues that we will face, because we have a serious issue with our drainage and our sewage, but those issues will be addressed as we learn from surveys and many other things that will face us. But again, this is not the Hammond that I grew up in. It's not the Hammond that I want to continue to grow up in. So I definitely will make the change. I feel as though it's my time. I've gotten the blessings of the good Lord above me when I asked for it, and it was my time, and I hope that you vote for me. I'm running for mayor, as you know, and it's, I hope to have your vote this November the 8th.
And candidate 4, Pete Penapinto.
Good evening, everyone. I'd like to thank North Shore Broadcasting and Tangible Chamber for putting on this event tonight. Tonight, we'll speak about my administration and the successes that we've had. First and foremost, I'd like to say that my wife and I have raised our children here in Hammond. I'm watching my son and my daughter-in-law raise my grandson here, Cooper, in Hammond. My 93-year-old mother, 79-year-old mother-in-law have been living with us for a few years now, and we all enjoy this beautiful town. I will say that it is a pleasure to be here. I'm a graduate of Southeastern, and I look forward to the debate tonight. Thank you, and I would ask you for your consideration and your vote for me. I'm number 66 on the ballot. Thank you.
All right, without further ado, we'll begin our questions. The first question, which will be posed first to Tracy. So there has been much discussion about Hammond's aging infrastructure, specifically sewage and drainage. What do you understand those issues to be, and how would you address these issues?
Well, considering that my degree is in public health, I'm very aware of the importance of infrastructure for sewage. On a personal note, during Hurricane Ida, I was one of many whose homes flooded with raw sewer. So that is an environmental concern as well. Not only that, the children who have been impacted by this have had respiratory issues, which is a side effect of sewer. Because we have such an aging infrastructure system, we can use the American Rescue dollars that are coming down the pipeline to make sure we have adequate engineering performed to replace and or repair the infrastructure that's currently in place. There's also additional funding from the federal government that can be acquired to cause the infrastructure to be repaired. Currently, they are performing cameras down the pipes to see where the holes are. We spend a lot of money on that. It's called sewer system rehabilitation. But in the process, when we find those, instead of plugging them, we should be repairing them. And that way we would not continue to have the leakage and the backup that we currently have. So that's what I would do.
And moving on to Daryl Smith. Daryl, you have 60 seconds. The same question. Also, you're allowed to ask me to repeat the question if I need to.
No, thank you so much. There's two schools of thought dealing with the sewage treatment facilities that drain into the marshlands. The environmentalists and you have the DEQ. So if the DEQ has permitted the sewage treatment plant, we need to ask what is based on that permit. Are there any clauses? Are there any additional requirements that we need to do as a community? The second thing is environmentalists. They have reported that the bed of the marshlands have become separated. They're floating vegetation, which means you can no longer walk out there unless you sink. You will sink 2-3 feet. So those are the two schools of thought. As mayor, I would bring both parties together, sit down with them, and come out with a comprehensive plan that everyone can agree on and we can move forward. As far as repairing leaking pipes, absolutely. We have to address that so in District 3, we no longer have homes that are backing up with sewage. It's unacceptable. Thank you.
Now, Johnny Pecoraro, you have 60 seconds.
Yes, sewage is one of the main issues that I'm in the campaign. Sewage is a terrible issue right now because you have to face the fact Hammond is a 200-year-old city with an infrastructure underneath that is totally crumbling, okay? So we have a lot of infrastructure problems within our system city, within the city itself. Now we have an issue with discharging it from our ponds, which is down Sea Fuji Falls, smell the wonderful odor there. So now we have a problem getting it to the pipeline out to Ponchatoula. The discharge, the DEQ is on our tails on that as well because it does not meet the standards that we are destroying the marshlands. So we have an infrastructure problem in the city with the crumbling system that it is, all of the four districts combined, and then we have a problem now with discharging it in the city to the sewage and to the swamplands. So I feel as though we have a lot of damage control still yet to do in both the city and also discharging it, and we will get it done.
And now, Pete, 60 seconds.
In the last 8 years, we've spent $14 million on our sewer system. We're in the process right now. We're finishing up that $14 million, and we're in the process right now of spending $5.5 million more on the system. We've done smoke tests. We've done camera tests. We've evaluated all the data, and we're getting ready to go out for bid on Thursday for the first phase of this last section of sewer work that we're doing. We have four spans. We have 55 lift stations that sewer gravitates to. And then because it's such a flat service, it gets pumped down to the ponds, the treatment ponds. That being said, District 3 is an area where this goes through. So what we've done and what's getting ready to be put in place right now is we have taken four lift stations. That's Phoenix Square, Mississippi Street, and two on Mooney Street. And put a force main from each one of these lift stations straight to the sewer pond, bypasses the neighborhood, straight to the sewer pond. In the sewer ponds, we had an issue with smell on Fagan Drive. If you're 10 seconds left. So that being said, we also have backup generators, 40 of our generator for our lift stations. We only have 15 left. That's why we were able to get through Ida without much of the sewer pond.
All right, thank you. Going on to question number two. If elected mayor, what do you think Hammond's biggest opportunities for economic development are, and how do you plan to implement your vision? Daryl, we'll start with you. 90 seconds.
Downtown Hammond is the seat of this parish. This is where everyone comes to entertain with restaurants and coffee shops. It is the heart and soul of our community. I encourage more mixed-use developments in downtown Hammond, more construction. I want to bring in more neighborhoods inside the city limits with restrictions. I want to move forward with new sidewalks and subsurface drainages in the neighborhoods that surround downtown Hammond. This is the place that everyone wants to live. We have so many compliments when people come to Hammond, they go to downtown, how beautiful it is, how unique our city is. So that is a tremendous engine for us. You can go to the malls, you can go down Thomas Street, you see vacancies. You go into downtown Hammond, you have no vacancies. It's the heart and soul of this community.
Johnny Pecoraro, 60 seconds.
Yes, I will say this, first of all, I think one of the best kept secrets in our entire city is Southeastern Louisiana University. I find that our administration does not have a marriage with our university. And speaking to Dr. Crane, Wendy Lauderdale, other people at Southeastern, I find it the best kept secret in the city. I would love to reunite with them one-on-one. I've spoken to them. They said that you have every department we have is open for you. And I said, well, I got one better for you. Downtown, there'll be a sign that says Southeastern Louisiana University, Hammond's Regional Office. I want you in my office as well. So I will coordinate in the development of downtown. And people ask me a lot of times, well, how are you going to afford this, okay? There are many ways. My downtown hotel I talked about, okay, that's private industry. The civic center that we talk about, that's private industry. So the retail stores that I want to attract, I'm going to go after, and I'll bring them here. There's no place to shop. Where do I send my mom? Dealers, okay, no offense to dealers, but we need more places, okay? So I feel go after the businesses that you want, and I will go after those that I want. I always made a standing joke and said I would never run for mayor unless there was a Ralph Lauren polo shop. Well, guess what? It's coming. So my signs up, my 10 seconds up. I talk very fast, so put your seatbelts on because it's going to be a long night.
And Pete, you have 60 seconds.
Well, since we've been in office, we've acquired a lot of companies in Hammond. Medline, Mayfair, Carvana, Chick-fil-A, around the mall, Firestone. We have the coffee shops. So many companies come to this town and they ask, what can we do to get in this town? I'm a contractor by trade. The main thing is to aid people and assist people through the process of getting what they need to do to be in place to open a business. And that's what we do. We've done it. We've done it for 8 years. We have the team to do it. We work with Ginger Canzalosi and Atangi Economic Development District. We're constantly bringing companies in. Companies come to this city and they say, they do the demographics. And they say, you're crazy. This is 20,000 citizens, 14,000 students. We can't bring this company here. Chick-fil-A comes in, largest amount of sales that they've had in any other companies. Home Depot, same thing. These companies come in and I tell us that this is a unique city. We have 5 interstate interchanges. 3 on 12, 2 on 55. Come join us and bring your businesses here in Hammond.
All right, thank you, Pete. And finally, Tracy.
Can you please repeat the question?
If elected mayor, what do you think Hammond's biggest opportunities for economic development are, and how do you plan to implement your vision?
The biggest opportunity for economic development in our city is our corridor of the I-55 and I-12. And increasing supply chain opportunities. As I'm going around speaking with people, especially the young people who attend Southeastern, they leave our city, and that's called brain drain. So we need to bring something in that will keep our young people here. And one thing that I would do, I'm data driven. So I believe in looking at the white papers of the Bureau of Labor Statistics and the Census Bureau. Our median income right now is $31,000. We're 37% poverty. So we need to bring in manufacturing jobs. We need to bring in jobs with automation and robotics. And in order to do that, I will partner with the Workforce Planning Commission to make sure that our young people and our mid-level people are trained to perform these jobs. Considering that Southeastern have a degree program in supply chain, I would also partner with Southeastern. Thank you.
All right, moving on to question number 3. It has been shown that investing in the success of our youth makes for a healthier community. What would your administration do to serve Hammond's youth? Johnny, we'll start with you.
There's a lot of things you can do with our youth that we overlook currently, okay? I put recently an article on my Facebook page that, I mean, what do you do here with your children on the weekends, number one. I got lashed back when I put down there, well, I like Top Golf. I'll speak to them. Maybe they'll come this way. I talked about having a few other things like a water park. People slam me down and say, well, we got a bowling alley. Okay, well, that's not enough to keep me here, my kids here on the weekends. And as far as youth, there needs to be many more programs for us to do on the weekends with our children during school, after school. But as far as developing industries, we need to develop more industries here that we can keep our kids here. When they graduate college, we don't get to see them here go to the 12th grade, and then they're gone, they graduate, and they move elsewhere to St. Tammany, Baton Rouge, whatever. So together with Southeastern and all of our people within our community, we can definitely develop more industry to come here. And just like we went after Medline, we can go after many other people, but we're going to have respect on the next person that we go after.
And Pete, you have 60 seconds.
I truly believe education is the key. We get to our children when they're young. I have the after-school program that I started when I was first here. We brought it to the recreation center. Any child in the Hammond School District gets bused over to the recreation center. They get all of their homework done. They get a nutritional snack, their homework done, a nutritional meal, any other extra homework needs that they have. We try to help tutor them with that. Then they get bused home. By the time they get home to the parent, they get love, kisses, and hugs, and put to bed. I created the air show again, brought the air show back, formed a 501c3. With that, we have given $40,000 to SIM programs and two air shows. Invest in your children. Do what Johnny was just talking about, and keep our kids home. Create jobs, bring jobs here, and have these jobs for these children so we do not have to lose our children to other cities like we've done for many years. My child included is now here running his own business. Thank you.
Tracy, you have 60 seconds.
One of the platforms of my campaign is expanded youth programs. Well, what does that look like? That looks like bringing back summer jobs so the children can earn money, right? Most of the crime that's committed right now by our youth offenders are because they're unsupervised. But if we create a program where they can shadow professionals and they can perform internships, and we can partner with schools, nonprofits, and churches, then we would give the children, the youth, something to do instead of being unsupervised. Thank you.
And moving on to Daryl, you have 60 seconds.
Thank you. Continuing education is the key for the youth, having them involved with after-school programs, summer programs, setting up computer systems at the athletic facilities, also having them, keeping them involved in swimming, baseball, and other programs during the summertime will keep them productive and engaged with what's going on. It would be wonderful to have a Big Brother program where a lot of the students can be adopted by a business owner and incorporate those young people into coming to work with us and watching what we do. Inspiration is the key to lowering crime. Thank you.
All right, moving on to question number four. Pete, you'll be the first to respond to this. You'll have 90 seconds. The police chief now serves at the pleasure of the mayor. What are your plans for your administration's police chief?
Pete. Well, I think the police chief's doing a good job. My police chief was a sergeant working under Calvin Miller as a lieutenant, and when I came in office, we created a street crime unit. I wanted an individual who would get out there and stop violent crime, get out there with our young police officers who are aggressive and want to save the world, but you need to keep them safe, someone who has wisdom and knows what they're doing. This police chief has done that. He has shown leadership, and that's the reason why he's police chief now. I think what we need to do is continue, and we've even started a gang crime unit where we monitor gangs. We have taken over 50 guns off the streets since March. This gang crime unit has just gotten in place in March. It's a social media thing for these gangs these days, more than what it used to be. So we have an individual who specifically tracks gangs, and we work with the judicial system. We keep these people off the streets. We try to revoke the bonds and not let them get out right after they commit the crime and stay out until they get back, until they go to the court system. We need to keep these folks off the streets. I think the police chief is doing a good job. I think he needs to continue doing the job he's doing, and I support him fully. We have a good team in the police department, and we're fighting crime every day.
Thank you, Pete. Now on to Tracy and your response to that question.
I come from a family that's full of law enforcement and military personnel. And if elected mayor, I would replace the current police chief. And the reason being, when he was appointed police chief, there was a tape that was circulating that some may know of and some may not, where he beat a handcuffed black man. I am the mother of a black child. And so that persuaded me in a different manner than most people would be at liberty to say. But we need a chief who believes in, one, community policing. And when I hire a police chief, it will be one who can succumb to the programs by the U.S. Department of Justice, which is known as community-oriented policing services, which have been shown to reduce crime. And there is funding that would not cost the taxpayers any more money to do these programs. So to answer your question, I would do a search for a chief who believes in community policing, one, and two, that believes that all persons, regardless of race, color, or creed, will be treated fairly and equal. Thank you.
Daryl, your response.
Thank you. I disagree with Pete. I think the police officer, the chief of police, has not performed well. He abused a gentleman in handcuffs, which is unacceptable. I think the crime is a pure indication that he does not have the ability to address those issues. When you have firearms shooting off in downtown Hammond at 2 o'clock in the morning, it's unacceptable. The crime is out of control. There's a disconnect. He does not know what to do. As mayor, I would interview and I would make a replacement. Thank you.
And Johnny, your response, you have 60 seconds.
My response is put your seatbelts on real tight. I am not at all happy with the current chief of police. On day one, he will be replaced, and I'll tell you why. I will look and hard search, and we have the best group right now put together from past chief police, FBI directors, everyone helping me research for his or her to replace the police chief in Hammond. I find that the morale has never been any worse ever in the history of the police department. I find that our current police chief has more complaints on him than anyone else, than any other police chief. I also find that my search of in searching for a police chief is not going to come with a videotape. It's not going to come with lawsuits that's been previously handled. And they will hold their department together. We finally have the salaries to attractive police officers, but we need a police chief that's going to be a leader and supportive of this police department that we all should be in support of.
All right, moving on to the fifth question, still on the topic of policing. There is a perception that crime is on the rise in Hammond. Do you agree with this perception, and what would your administration do to address crime? Tracy, we'll start back with you.
Yes, I do agree with that. Crime is on the rise, and if you look at any of the statistics, it's mostly youth juveniles that's doing it. I had the opportunity to work with at-risk juveniles at a school in A-Meet, Northwood Preparatory, some of you may know it. And there were intervention programs that needed to be in place to give the students an alternative. What I would do, again, is there's a program through the Department of Justice where you can take and partner with the schools and fund school resource officers, particularly with at-risk juveniles. And so they will build a relationship with these juveniles and follow them and do things outside of school in the community with them and build that relationship to give them an alternative. In addition to that, you would have programs in place that would give them after school activities. They have to have something extracurricular to do. And that goes back to that unsupervised group of kids or youth that are not there. But it's not just the youth. Poverty has a lot to do with crime. Currently, we have a 37% poverty rate. Until we bring jobs that are above living wage, where people can take care of their families, we will not be able to necessarily bring down crime. So one, bring in jobs, and two, expand youth programs that will give the young people something to do.
Daryl, you're next to respond to that question. You have 60 seconds.
Repeat that question, please.
Sure will. Still on the topic of policing, there is a perception that crime is on the rise in Hammond. Do you agree with this perception, and what would your administration do to address crime?
Well, absolutely, crime is on the rise. What we need to do is have police officers more visible. In downtown Hammond, we need to put them walking the sidewalks. Let them be visible to everyone. We used to have police officers riding on their bicycles through the neighborhood. They should be in the neighborhood monitoring what's going on. After-school programs, summer programs are fantastic for the young people. Again, continuing education, athletic programs, keep the young people busy. You need to, in order to solve, in my opinion, to solve the problems that we're having in downtown Hammond, we need to go back to putting these police officers in these nightclubs as undercover police officers, so they know what's going on. They can see if there's drugs, and they can protect the students and all the young people that are in downtown Hammond.
And Johnny, you have 60 seconds to respond.
Repeat the question, please.
Will do. There is a perception that crime is on the rise in Hammond. Do you agree with this perception, and what would your administration do to address crime?
I definitely agree that crime is on the increase. Everyone knows crime is on the increase. Common sense tells you. If you don't, it's just a police officer in the crowd tonight. They'll tell you if crime is under control. Because if you call for public records, as I did, for the year 2020, they gave me two reports. I called for 2021, I got two reports. I found out just this week, we have seven DWIs in an entire year in this city. Okay, out of 22,500 people, you have seven DWIs, and then there's one set, oh, you have two. Well, so yes, crime is definitely out of control, so what are we doing to increase it? I'm gonna change the situation. As Daryl says, you're gonna see a cop walk around the block one day, and you're gonna be in shock, and you walk out, and you say, hello, officer, what are you doing walking down the street? You know, so you're gonna have a walk patrol. I'm also gonna do a mounted division patrol, which I already got, it's lined up, okay? And this is gonna be done by a federal grant, a mounted horse patrol for special occasions. So I'm gonna do a lot to change crime in our city. And you will see it happen very quickly on day one.
And Pete, your response, 60 seconds.
Well, we continually aggressively police. You know, crime, a lot of the crimes, the shootings, as we know, has been going on for 7 years across the country. It's rampant. But God forbid, God bless ourselves that this city has not had in the city limits of Hammond this year a murder. It could happen today, tonight, any minute. We know it can happen. I do not believe in defunding the police. We fought for policemen's raise for 4 years. We finally did get it. Went from $29,000 a year to $45,000 a year with their post-certification. Now they're starting at $51,000 a year. Now we're getting better police officers. I believe in training. We've sent police officers for 9 months to train. They come in and people were taking them from us. Now we'll get a police officer that's post-certified. He automatically comes in 2 or 3 weeks and he's on the street, he's on the beat. We have grants that put police officers in clubs at night. That's not announced, but we have grants and we do have police officers in clubs at night. We do walk the beat at night on Thursdays and the weekends as well on downtown Hammond on Kate Street as well. We went from 7 officers on a shift to 11 officers on a shift after this raise. We are increasingly doing our job with the police department.
All right, moving on to our sixth question of the evening. All Hammond City Council seats are up for re-election this term, and only one seat is not contested. Relations between the mayor's office and the council have been overtly strained for this most recent term. If you were elected mayor, how would you work with the newly elected council? We'll start off with you, Daryl, 90 seconds.
Well, I'll have a peace plan in place for sure. I believe in talking, communicating, and working together with all of the councilmen. I'm not interested in confrontations. I want to make peace. You don't work 40 years in the real world without accomplishing, having a successful track record. So that lends my experience well to work well with all of the councilmen. So with that, you get things done in short order. Things are accomplished. The city is moving forward. But you can't fight. You have to make peace. Thank you.
All right, moving on to Johnny's response. You have 60 seconds, John.
Repeat the question, please.
Will do. All Hammond City Council seats are up for re-election this term, and only one seat is not contested. Relations between the mayor's office and the council have been overtly strained for this most recent term. If you are elected mayor, how would you work with the newly elected council?
First of all, I will work with every city council person with a one-on-one relationship, first of all. Okay, I've watched the council this past time. With all due respect, it's like watching the Jerry Springer show. So I usually try and watch it on YouTube, and then because I see the administration fighting, and then I see the council fighting, and it's almost an embarrassment. I've had friends from Washington D.C. call me and say, "Johnny, we watched your YouTube of your city council meeting the other night. Whenever your mayor called one of your council people a liar on stage." But again, you have to separate your differences. No matter what, you have to have a one-on-one relationship with your council, whether you like them or not. They represent the district. They were elected by their districts, so you have to respect that opinion of them. But you don't have to agree with them, but you do have to respect them on that. So I would have a one-on-one relationship with each and every one of them. And the Jerry Springer show needs to end.
And Pete, your response, you have 60 seconds.
We have a couple of people on the council that are self-serving. You have 2 weeks between meetings where we can get things done. You come to the administration, you tell us what you want to get done, and we get it done for you. You don't come to the day of the meeting not having any communication with us, and then bring up the questions that we have to go back and revisit to get you answers to. You said it, it's a show, and that's what it's all about. We're here to help, we're here to work for the citizens, and despite all of this disarray, we're still able to accomplish a lot of things in the last 8 years, despite this.
And moving on to Tracy, your response.
Thank you. The City Council is the legislative body for the City of Hammond, and the mayor's seat is the executive body for the City of Hammond. So you will work collectively and collaboratively to get things done. The responsibility of the City Council is to make the budget and to make policy. The position of the mayor is to execute that and administer that. So when I'm mayor, I would work collaboratively with the City Council, men and women, and get the job done. Thank you.
And moving on to question number 7, what about your experience and leadership style makes you the best candidate for mayor? We'll start off with Johnny. You have 90 seconds.
Because I know I am. Number one. Number two, it's because I have the desire to do it. I have the love and the passion to do it. You know, this is something I chose to do. I'm very comfortable in my environment that I am in, okay? But I do feel it's my time, it's my calling to achieve the goals. This is not the Hammond that I grew up in, and I will change that. I remember walking down Main Street, Hammond, being a baby stroller, walking down my whole life, going to college, working at Ferrera Shoe Store my way through college. I remember when Hammond was a safe environment to walk. So, yes, I would do a lot to change Hammond to a better Hammond today, because I'm not very happy with the Hammond that it is today. So I'll do whatever I can to change it, and I will change it, and I know I can get my thing that I want to do. I can do it. I always have, and I always will.
All right, moving on to Pete. You have 60 seconds to respond to that question.
I'm a businessman. My family's had a seaplane business since the 50s. I've grown up working all of my life, and I've grown up leading by example. I was taught that way. I was taught to get the job done no matter what. And if you need to step out there and work with your team, you do that. And I've done that so often in the parks. I've done that in the streets. And I've done anything as far as driving vehicles. And also working with my leadership team in the office, getting things done, getting grants. $14 million in grants in the last 8 years have come through our grant department. $13 million of grant money has rehabbed that airport out there and those facilities. Working to get things done, bringing dollars to the city of Hammond and making this place a better place to live for the citizens is my goal, to do the best job I can do and to lift up the people around me and help them get the job done as well. Thank you.
And Tracy, you have 60 seconds to respond.
Yes, thank you. As an investigator, federal officer for the U.S. Food and Drug Administration, I've learned to break things up into systems. The city of Hammond is made up into 5 districts, and each one of those districts have different needs. A leader is only as good as his or her team. So you have to work with the department heads to make sure that all the services are being done in all 5 districts. I've worked in every level of government, from state to federal, as well as local. And so you identify the issues and you come up with a solution. And then you have those meetings with your team to make sure that they can be efficient and effective with the taxpayers' money. Thank you.
And Daryl, you have 60 seconds to respond.
Repeat that question.
Sure will. What about your experience and leadership style makes you the best candidate for mayor?
Well, coming here in 1987 with $187 in my pocket, working, graduating from Southeastern, going to starting a company from scratch and working for 4 decades, I've learned a lot from the people that I've dealt with. And spending 10 years on a community bank board, spending 4 terms on the state mineral board, you learn to work with people, and you learn how to get things done. So that all that experience, I think, will lend well as mayor of the city of Hammond. Thank you.
And our 8th and final question. If you were elected mayor and you were given a magic wand to immediately implement your top 2 priorities, what would those 2 priorities be and why? And we'll start off with Pete. You have 90 seconds.
Well, first of all, I would keep and continue to try to raise money for the city of Hammond and to continue to provide the services that we do for the citizens of Hammond. We have, I've heard talk about drainage and sewer. We have put dollars in the sewer. We're going to continue to rehab this sewer system, our drainage system in our city. We're going to continue to help businesses come into the city. We're going to continue to work and strive for a better Hammond. Live, play, and work in Hammond is the motto. That's what everybody wants. We all want to live there. We want a safe environment. We're going to continue to support our police department, and we're going to continue to strive for the best Hammond we can be.
And moving on to Tracy, you have 60 seconds.
With a magic wand, to choose 2 things is quite hard. But the first one would absolutely be dealing with public safety, because that's the number one concern that I hear when I'm canvassing the neighborhoods. So community policing and reducing crime. The second thing would be turn on the lights. That's the second most imperative thing that I've heard from the constituents. Hammond is very dark across the city. So if I had a magic wand on day 1, I would turn on the lights that the people have been complaining about being dark, which again would reduce public safety. Thank you.
And Daryl, your response. You have 60 seconds.
Thank you. I'd eliminate crime with that magic wand, and I'd complete the sidewalks and subsurface drainage and all throughout our community so it would invite more people to come and live within our city limits. And again, the key to economic growth is reinvesting in your community. What has made Hammond shine over these years is the fact that we took these old buildings from the 80s and the 90s and we redeveloped them and made them mixed-use developments. That's why we're enjoying so much prosperity in downtown Hammond. And that radiates to all the communities that surround our downtown. Thank you.
And Johnny, you have 60 seconds to respond.
And you don't have to repeat the question. I heard it. Okay, if I had a magic wand, the first thing I'd do would be eliminate crime or try to eliminate crime by turning on the lights. I could land a 747 in Ponchatoula, Highway 22, I could land another 747. I come downtown, Hammond, Louisiana, we win the Main Street American Award for down street, okay? We'll come down during the daytime, don't come down at nighttime. So yeah, we gotta turn the lights on, number one, for us to reducing crime, to solve crime. My second thing that I would do is definitely work on the sewage and drainage issue, because right now we have a moratorium. I'm against moratoriums. You're stopping our city from growing, so we have to solve the infrastructure problems so we can grow in Hammond. We don't want moratoriums to tell us not to grow. You have to grow. So my second wish would be to take care of the drainage and sewage issue so our town can grow in the moratoriums and let us grow. And let our 73 restaurants be known as 73 great restaurants, and not let it be known as a crime-infested city that you can't visit at nighttime to the restaurants. Thank you.
All right, thank you all for sharing your thoughts on these important topics as you vie for Hammond's mayoral office. We will now allow each candidate 2 minutes for closing remarks this evening. We'll start with Tracy Wells Washington.
Thank you. It is absolutely an honor and a privilege to be here tonight, to have answered the questions that were presented to me, to have an open discussion so you can make an informed decision on November the 8th. My educational and my work experience have well prepared me to sit in this seat and to be your next mayor. I believe in servant leadership, that you serve the people who elect you, not some people, but all people. We have a beautiful city. But it's not just downtown. Downtown is very well suited, and it's thriving under the leadership of the Downtown Development District. But we have 5 districts in whole that should be well taken care of and provided for. So my vision for the city of Hammond is to be one Hammond rising, a thriving city for every man, woman, and child, a transparent and a trustworthy government operating with 21st century technology. I thank you for your time tonight. And I hope you consider me for your support on November the 8th. I am Tracy Washington Wells, number 70 on the ballot.
And Daryl, you have 2 minutes for your closing remarks.
Thank you. What makes our community so wonderful is our families. It's you and I. We raise our families here. We work here. We protect this community. That's what makes Hammond so wonderful. In the 4 or 5 districts that we have to work hard to protect that. Reinvestment in our city is essential for our growth. And through economic growth, you have prosperity, which is spread to everyone. I have spent 40 years working in this community. I have been educated. I am a product of Southeastern. I am a product of this community. I am a product of the board of directors that ran community banks 30 and 40 years ago. Those families allowed me and you and many small businesses to prosper. Our prosperity, our future is that we have to work together. We come here, people come here to retire. People come here and live to raise their families. We cannot do that if we don't address the crime. The mayor's job is to solve the garbage, the drainage, the sewage, issues of this community. That is imperative. We cannot prosper when you have districts with sewage backing up into their homes. So teamwork is the solution. Thank you so very much.
Johnny, you now have 2 minutes for closing remarks.
I entered this race because it's a love of the city of Hammond, because I love Hammond. I think it's a beautiful town, and I love the city of Hammond is why I'm in this race. I'm in this race because of you. You are the people that have to decide who is the best person to lead you into the next 4 years of what you want to see the city grow and do. I know it was a hard decision when I made my decision to do this at this time, because it's a very difficult decision to be an administrator of a city. You always get the ending story of it's going to always wind up in your lap, as you know, Pete. They always give you the final say-so, and you're going to be the person that's going to get the ending results. But My mother was my biggest inspiration in this race, and because my mother said it best of all, my mother would, the night I announced my candidacy, my mother died and passed away. She was with me tonight here by my side the entire time, and she's my greatest inspiration. She gave me the best advice. She said, Johnny, do what you've always done your whole life. You've been blessed your whole life because you've always been within the elements of beauty, design, decorating, whether it's the flower business. You provided beauty your entire life. If you love the city of Hammond as much as you say you love Hammond, then let that be your legacy. Let that be your lifelong ending. So you provide the city. Leave it beautiful that you love it. So do your best you can and follow your dreams of your what your family taught you with family values and follow your heart. And that way you can never go wrong because I do love my city. I love my mom. She is with me tonight.
And Pete, you have 2 minutes for your closing remarks.
Well, crime seems to be what we've addressed the most. And I tell you, we've addressed it with this administration. We have software now for the police officers that will, this software will tell us what districts has how much crime in it, at what location, what gangs are affiliated with it, and it all gets back to a software that will go into the next day or the next shift's crews so we can educate them on where they need to be on that particular day because it changes day to day. Spending dollars on crime is what we've been doing since we've been in office. We're aware of the crime, we're on top of the crime, and we're going to fight it, and we're going to keep fighting it, and we're going to keep spending money on it. We're going to train, and we're going to retrain our people, and we're going to try to be the best we can be. When it comes to the sewer system, as I said, we spent $20 million by the end of this term on sewer. 14's gone, $5.5 million right now is getting ready to be put in place, and we're helping all districts. We want to help every district. We want to do what's right for this community. We are spending money where it belongs. We're blessed that we have a lot of economic development in this city because we aggressively have helped people come here and they want to be here. We have young tech companies. We have a lot of young people that are coming here because they want to live here because it is a safe place to be. And it has good, quick access to New Orleans, Baton Rouge, Slidell. We have a lot of opportunity in here. I'm very proud of what we've done with the city of Hammond. I ask you all to consider me for your vote. And let me continue my last term to continue the good work that the city and our team has done for the last 8 years. Thank you so much.
All right, thank you all for your participation and for your willingness to serve. This concludes our City of Hammond Mayoral Forum. Thank you, North Shore Media Groups, Tangi 96.5, and the Tangi Boho Chamber for hosting this event, and to AN17 for making the video available to the public. We encourage everyone to engage the voting process by researching your local elections and voting. Early voting is October 25th until November the 1st, and Election Day is November the 8th. On behalf of Tangi 96.5, I'm Johnny Chauvin. Good night, everyone.
I'm Attorney Pat Dunn. Auto accidents are a part of life. I hope you never need an attorney, but if you do, the team at the Mack Law Firm is here to help. Don't be intimidated by large insurance companies who just want to make your problem go away. We are here to represent your rights and interests. Contact me today at TangiLawTeam.com and let's get to work.